None of us do.
All right. I don't think I need the microphone. I want to welcome you all.
Oi!
Thanks, Bill. I want to welcome you all to the conference's sixth panel on displacement. We have four speakers in this panel, and our first is a man who has just told me that he needs no introduction, which I think is true, William Engel, who is the Nick B. Williams Professor of English. He has a handout, so I'll just sort of sneak around and hand this out as he speaks.
Thank you, Abby. I appreciate it so much, and thank you all for coming and being here. For you current students and presenters, thank you for wearing your gowns. I'm so glad to see so many members of the Order of the Gown here today. My remarks this morning are going to revisit a perennial specter still haunting Europe today, Judeophobia. I will bring to prominence key moments in the ever-abiding composite imaginary Jew and pan-European consciousness. My point of departure is the pre-modern figure of the wandering Jew, the migratory, displaced figure par excellence in the European political imagination. To be sure, this figuration is different from wanderers today, those hoping to be taken in anywhere, whether or not they are considered refugees. The Jew of the Middle Ages had no such status, however, and when allowed to settle, was taxed at a much higher rate. And taxation also was a way of taking census, who was where, and often they were robbed outright, expelled, or murdered. The first slide here, I don't want to minimize, though, the plight of the modern-day displaced persons, but simply, by way of a passing comparison, I want today to explain the terms by virtue of which the Jew was subjected to a different set of often quite arbitrary laws, differing region to region, prince to prince, bishop to bishop, depending on any of innumerable factors, though usually financially motivated and bolstered by blatant racism and anti-Semitism. This being the half millennium celebration of Martin Luther's famous pronouncements in Wittenberg, many people aren't aware that toward the end of his life, as things were moving differently from how he saw the Reformation, he spoke about and published a tract called On the Jews and Their Lies in 1543. And that's a picture of it that Cranach did the cover title for. Luther is fairly typical of the day in his expression of this attitude when he wrote, and in English translation, "We let them, the Jews, get rich on our sweat and blood while we remain poor and they suck the marrow from our bones." And I put this alongside of the blood libel to show he's speaking both figuratively, symbolically, and literally of the notion of the blood libel where Jews were alleged to have bled Christian children and indeed sucked marrow from the bones. So it's a fascinating turn of language. Charting out recognizable moments in the development and projection of the Jewish imaginary, the early modern period enables us to see other Europes from the inside out. And here I have a quick map of the Jewish expulsions. I can't really call it a diaspora. Although Judeophobia is pan-European in its sweep and scope, there are decisive Germanic roots to be found in late medieval legislation concerning Jews as wanderers, as aliens who have penetrated precinct borders and shed traces of their foreignness, making them indistinguishable from native citizens. And so the need for laws to make Jews wear clear and distinct marks of difference in the form of easily recognized hats and badges. In the back of your handout, I've given you just a sampling of some of the ordinances across Europe, culminating in England, which is one of my principal areas of study. The Judenhut is what, or the Jew hat, is pretty interesting and typical. Here, this is just showing the great poet Suskind von Grimburg, depicted, we know he's a Jew because he's got the Judenhut on. And this rendering from the 13th century where we see the bearded, well-shod, and I'm going to come back to shoes in a moment, and barefootedness, this ancient Semitic mantle and garb. This on the left is contemporary, and there they're imagined as kind of ancient. It translates or moves is read back into biblical Judaic imaginary, so that the prophet Daniel gets depicted as a Jew with a 12th century Yonah, and the Nativity also from 12th century Germany with Mary and Joachim shown wearing the egregious. There he is on the far right. It's a fascinating depiction in so many ways. This is what y'all have on your handout. I'll just focus on the bottom one from the Statue of Jewelry of Edward. The two tables joined, one of yellow felt, length of 6 inches and the breadth of 3 inches. We remember also the legislation of the Yellow Star of David in 1940 throughout Hitler's Europe, also at very specific dimensions of size and shape. It's not a new thing. Difficult to see, but this is the two tablets and how big they were supposed to have been of a Jew being beaten or persecuted, ironically wearing the Ten Commandments. We can save that for later. Along with these imposed marks of difference came new sets of tropes and telltale signs of physical features that validated the images, giving rise to the Jewish imaginary. So here this Jew from Homs is showing holding garlic because we all know Jews stink and they have to keep kosher and so they eat these vegetables. Well, that explains it. The rondelle was one of the Central European marks of Jewishness. And yes, he's carrying a money bag. And this is a fairly late recreation in a chapbook. Here's some more recognizable features. The Jew is moneylender, quite the egregious nose. Glad we got the profile. At the same time, there always were parallel traditions of the Jew as wanderer with a walking staff, with bare feet and the beard. No walking staff here, but the Jew without shoes. This is going to be interesting because part of the legend, as I'll share in a moment, has to do with the first wandering Jew being a cobbler, someone who makes shoes. You'll notice on my bibliography, one of the most fascinating volumes that I've encountered, I think it's one of the last on the list, is an essay I took from a collection called Jews and Shoes, all the way up, culminating with the shoe collection at Auschwitz and the suitcases. So it has some poignancy. Curiously, these and other related descriptors of the wandering Jew share many features of the eternal hunter motif from Teutonic mythology, exemplified by the restlessness and the restless wandering, the contract maker, Wotan. At the same time, there's a discernible Semitic point of origin of the iconography of the singular wandering Jew, with a staff of apocryphal tales and legend intersecting with the life and passion of Christ. And here we'll go for one of our origin stories for this Jewish imaginary. One such telling comes from the Chronicles of the Abbey of St. Albans. In 1228, and I'll read in an English transcription, a certain archbishop of Armenia came on pilgrims to England who said he had met the wandering Jew, singular, and knew his story. When thereupon the Jews were dragged forth, this is the speaker, the Armenian, the Jews were dragging Jesus forth from Pontius Pilate and had reached the door. Cartophilus, the porter of the hall in Pilate's service, as Jesus was going out of the door, impiously struck him on the back with his hand and said in mockery, "Go quicker, Jesus, go quicker. Why do you loiter?" A 1542 account picks up this narrative. Thereupon Jesus had looked hard at him and said, "I shall stand here and rest, but you shall wander forth and be everlastingly restless." Then he saw Jesus die on the cross, but could not possibly return to his people in Jerusalem. Ever since, he's been a wanderer on the face of the earth and longed for death, unable to die until Christ returned. Next slide, please. Thank you. Whether shown in the turban or the Phrygian cap, the iconography of the Levantine or Oriental Jew with his outlandish head dressing, in fact, became reality by law. Christian control over the Jews was well served by making them into images, into spectacles of alterity, thereby sustaining and ever renewing their exclusion. This is especially evident in the sumptuary laws for the Jews. Also, some are listed on the back of the handout. the Rheinfleisch massacres, for example. We could see the codified Jew in the Oriental headdress as benignly and not so benignly being burned alive. In cities like Worms and Würzburg, they had particularly strident rules, and especially in Rottingen, the epicenter of the so-called Rheinfleisch massacres of April 20th, the anniversary is coming up soon, in 1298, instigated by a Franconian nobleman who sought ostensibly to avenge the desecration of the host, which, like the blood libel, never ceased to incite Jew-baiting among the populace. Here's an image of desecration of the host, done, by the way, not by Jewish artists, but reporting on, as it were, this event resulting in 26 Jews being burned, the legend being Jews would steal the Eucharist, the host, and bleed it, or, I mean, it's Christ's body, and so there's all kinds of interesting things we could talk about later, but tempus fugit. With his accomplices, the Franconian minister burned all of the Jews of the town who were easily rounded up. Why? Because of the state required outlandish clothing and marks of difference that identified them as Jews, but more so because they were restricted to dwell in specific areas. And these later, from Italy on, will be called ghettos or the Jewish quarter or Jewry, as sometimes. The mob from Würzburg on July 20th moved on to other neighboring villages and communities, and within the next 6 months, 120 congregations were destroyed, and in Bavaria and Austria, 100,000 people, it's estimated, were murdered. Judeophobia, though, hardly was confined to Germany alone, as the exclusion map I've shown you indicates, and here we'll see it again. And neither were the sumptuary laws, laws regarding clothing, nor the legal proceedings against entire Jewish communities for allegedly abducting and killing Christian children. Here's another image of around Passover, how Jews needed the blood to make the matzah, the unleavened bread for sacred ritual. So went the allegation, the so-called blood libel, linked closely to the desecration of those that I've suggested. As well as Jews poisoned wells, they killed livestock, they spread disease, indeed all of those things that threatened the health and integrity of the community, things which by the later Middle Ages also would be ascribed to witches. Yes, witches. The transference onto the witch of the features, garb, and attire of the Jew, crooked nose, pointy hats, voluminous mantle, strange cauldrons, as well as alien status, no fixed abode or roots in our community, speaking in arcane tongues and languages. In short, all of those things pointing to their being not from another place, but in league with the devil. The attributed antipathy of Jews that they were said to have toward Christ in the Middle Ages as killers of Christ, in quotes, further linked them to the demonic as standing over and against the truth of the Christian religion in general and of Christ in particular, hence the perceived need of Jews to obtain and desecrate the host. Whereas the wandering Jew was appropriated as a living proof text of Christian teleology and eschatology. He, the wandering Jew in singular, was granted extraordinary mortality, unable to die until the second coming of Christ. This is the negative instantiation complementing the positive of Veronica's veil. Veronica, of course, stooped to help Christ as he stumbled on his way to Calvary, and in this act of compassion of wiping his face with her linen shawl, leaving forever an impression of Jesus' face, still visible today and venerated by many. And time permitting, we could perhaps talk about whether in the extent to which Benedict XVI implicitly venerated Veronica's veil, and we could talk about rituals, rites, and relics. Both Veronica's veil and the wandering Jew's future testimony to be given at a later date, seen as enduring signs of Christ's exceptionalism, bear witness to his Christ-projected return. The one, Veronica, an act of charity, the other, the Jew, a mocking rebuff, which through faith and penance leads to eventual release. An eyewitness of both the death and the resurrection, the wandering Jew alone can testify at the end of days that this is the same messianic Christ who left the world and returns at last to redeem it. In the same way the scoffing Cartophilus converted to Christianity, and in other version he's a cobbler named Ahasuerus, Luther expected all Jews to convert to his Reformed version of Christianity. And when they did not, he turned against them vehemently. Again, I quote from Of the Jews and Their Lies. In brief, dear princes and lords, those of you who have Jews under your rule, do not grant them protection, safe conduct, or communication with us. And so, in the 16th century, the Jew wandered eternally across Europe. Chapbooks perpetuated the story of the singular wandering Jew, especially in the 17th century. And we see it also circulating in forms and translations in the 18th century. This much circulated image of the day, 18th century, more sanguine views of the Jews prevailed among freethinkers such as Sir Thomas Browne, who investigated specific stereotypes that they stink, he attributed scientifically to the nature of their necessitated diet of root vegetables, thus beginning to break the cycle of the perpetuated vulgar errors informing the Jewish imaginary in pre-Enlightenment Europe, and a marked evolution in and domestication of the image, both in its composition and in the message it conveyed. We can begin to see throughout Europe in the 19th century a more romantic and sympathetic reimagining of the wandering Jew as such. Romanticism, if I could generalize, imposed a culturally, politically, and socially significant itinerary on the figure of the wandering Jew. Still the same image, just revalanced in a different way. The Jew is solitary, tragic hero, plunged into terrible, pathetic solitude. Eugène Sue's novel Le Juif Errant of 1844 renewed and popularized this figure, sympathetically turning him into an allegory of the fight for social justice. In my recent research on another thing, I found that Edgar Allan Poe did a review of Sue's book, and one of the things Poe didn't like is his treatment of the Jesuit, who he thought a Jesuit would never behave the way he is in that novel. But he had nothing to say about the Jew. That's what I was hoping he would say, but he didn't. He's more interested in social relations. Further sympathy we can begin to see directed in this case against the Tsar of Russia and the great migration of the Jews from Russia across Europe in the 1860s and moving into the 1880s. Notwithstanding these humanistic impulses, social anxieties continue to circulate, especially as regards contemporary responses to the assimilated modern Jew, reaching its most horrific realization of the Jewish imaginary, of course, during National Socialism in Germany, figured, as was the case later in 1942 at the Wannsee Conference, the Jew was a troubling question finally to be resolved. The Endlösung der Judenfrage, the answer or conclusion of the Jewish problem. Memories and features of the Jewish wanderer remain an indelible and unexpungible part of the entrenched symbolic register of Europe's deep-seated cultural imagination and political unconscious. Acknowledging this and factoring it into our analysis, I think, is the beginning of any future work toward a critique of other Europes. The broader scope of my project on pre-modern memory and counter-memory asks us finally to see in the everlasting Jew a prescient model for making sense of and for reconsidering contemporary attitudes toward the confinement, exclusion, and rejection of the stateless, the homeless, the refugee. Thank you.
Thank you. We're going to hold the questions until the end of all the speakers. So our next speaker is Anne Kirk, who is a senior international and global studies major, speaking on French laïcité, republicanism, and its impact on the Franco-Maghrebi identity. Let's make sure that's recorded.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Hello, everyone. My name is Anne Kirk, and this was the thesis I wrote for my IGS major. Entitled French Laïcité, Republicanism, and its Impact on the Franco-Maghrebi Identity. And I focus on immigrants from the Maghreb, consisting of Morocco, Tunisia, and Algeria, because they make up the largest non-European ethnic group in France today, consisting of between four and 6 million people. Oh, I need the slide changer. This past July of 2016, the mayor of Cong, David Lisnard, banned the burkini on public beaches, calling them the uniform of extremist Islamism. Although the French Council of State overturned the ban, several French mayors enforced their bans in the face of this ruling. The scandal has sparked a worldwide media frenzy, targeting women who, in their minds, are dressing appropriately according to their religious beliefs. Although not much different from scuba diving suits, the swimwear has been interpreted as a symbol of the enslavement of women, and a humiliation for the women who are wearing them by the men who support France's strict secularism. The issue of the burkini ban clearly separates those in France into two groups. The first are those who see these laws as an infringement on religious freedom, and the second are those who see Islamic dress as inconsistent with France's rigorously enforced secularism. Although open to immigration, France is the European country most insistent on assimilation, believing that immigrants should assimilate to French culture, education, language, and economy as fast as possible, establishing a religious problem out of a social and political issue. My thesis explores France's discouragement of hybridization in four parts. The first is French laïcité and exceptionalism, second is immigrants and French assimilation, third, French Islam, and fourth, ideologies of the extreme right. Laïcité can be translated as the absence of religious involvement in government affairs and the absence of government involvement in religious affairs. And it was solidified by the law of separation of 1905, which strove to continue the goals of the French Revolution. Although France has been strongly secular for the last century, the country was ruled by the Roman Catholic Church for more than a millennium, creating a Catholic tone to the French secularism. And there are many Catholic reminders throughout France, such as large cathedrals that you see in every French village, town, and city. On March 15, 2004, France passed the law on secularity and the banning of conspicuous religious symbols, conspicuous meaning standing out, attracting notice or attention. This law is unique to France and is sadly not the only restrictive state policy geared towards Muslims. Another law would be the April 2011 law, making it illegal to hide one's face in public. These laws target headscarves and veils worn by a specific section of the Muslim community. Yet the symbolism of the ban is powerful, as both sides of the debate claim the same goal, the protection of human rights and religious freedom. Forced to the margins of society, the largest percentage of immigrants from the Maghreb live in les banlieues, or suburbs of large French cities like Paris and Marseille. And although they are called the suburbs of the city, they have the same socioeconomic makeup of what we call the inner city in America. The banlieue is the place where American tourists are told not to go, as they are seen as extremely dangerous places marked by drugs, gangs, and violence. As the banlieue become the most affordable option for immigrants, those from the Maghreb are typically forced out of the center of society, politics, economics, and mainstream culture. For the most part, there is a generational difference between the interpretation of French secularism. Older generations of immigrants continue to feel like foreigners in France, identifying more with their country of origin, which is why the older generation of immigrants might feel more grateful for what France has given them in terms of economic benefits, opportunities, and rights. Members of the second generation of immigrants, however, focus primarily on the wrongs they see in French society on a daily basis. Growing up in France, speaking French, and attending French schools, the feelings of rejection when the younger generation encounters racism can lead to an identity crisis, which can manifest itself in many ways. First, the rejection of Islam by French society can cause confusion about one's identity, possibly leading to the manipulation of young people by Muslim fundamentalists. Second, this rejection can also lead to the modification of Muslim values by a large portion of the younger generation of Muslim immigrants as a wish to be more included in popular society, which can mean rejection of the veil, for example. Attempting to create an umbrella organization to represent the Muslim population in France, the French Council of the Muslim Faith, or the CFCM, was founded in 2003 by the French state. The CFCM was formed to serve as an official interlocutor to the state in the regulation of Islamic worship. The council started as beneficial to both the state and the Muslim population, but the high level of state involvement in the regulation of the CFCM has created confusion about what or whom the council represents. By creating this representative body, the French state brought Islam under the power of the Republic and attempted to assimilate the religion by cutting the links between Muslim immigrants in their country of origin, making a clear distinction between foreign Islam and French Islam. And even former President Nicolas Sarkozy said that he aimed to create an Islam of France rather than an Islam in France. Despite their minority status in French society, however, a form of hybridized culture has entered into the popular sphere, rye music. Originating in Algeria, pop rye music had won over most of the immigrant population in France in the mid-1980s, even entering the public sphere through popular radio programs such as Radio Burr. And Burr is a term designating the second and third generation immigrant population in France. The music gave the youth a voice to express their cultural freedom throughout a society that requires cultural assimilation. Rye music serves as an example of the hybridization caused by immigration. Even though France strives to suppress the blending of non-Franco cultures, rye music proves that globalization cannot be ceased through attempts made by the government. And this is a quote by Joan Gross, who I read several times while writing my thesis. She said, "The diaspora experience is defined, not by essence or purity, but by the recognition of a necessary heterogeneity and diversity, by a conception of identity which lives with and through, not despite difference, by hybridity." The Front National was formed in 1972 by Jean-Marie Le Pen, a Catholic conservative and a veteran of the Algerian War. The National Front serves as France's far-right nationalist party, striking fear in most immigrants as the political party holds a strong anti-immigrant stance. Political parties like the National Front deepen the hostility between the Republic and immigrants, solidifying a West versus the rest mentality. With the rise of the Front National, immigrants are able to witness the ever-growing xenophobia throughout France. So after writing my thesis, I came to a few conclusions. First, culture and Le Banlieu are hives of globalization, mixing French society with Muslim beliefs. The implications of France's strict secularism has forced those of Maghreb descent to the outskirts of society, as immigrants fiercely feel the effects of La Cité. Although La Cité was based on equality for all, recent laws have morphed this idea into intolerance toward the others in French society. And personally, I believe that the continuous back and forth in France over Islam will continue as long as the country attempts to fight back their fear of terrorism through bigotry and the suppression of religion. France is just one example of the extreme marginalization of Muslim immigrants faced throughout Western countries. My topic hits incredibly close to home when you consider the marginalization of Muslim immigrants in the United States, solidified by the rise of the extreme right. The proposed travel ban is an example of an uneducated call based on stereotypes that only increases the immense polarization of the United States. Nothing will change as long as the U.S. treats unique ethnicities, religions, cultures, or races with hate rather than acceptance. I hope that we may continue to uplift and support those in our community of immigrant origin. And as a country founded by immigrants, I truly hope that one day we will overcome this unacceptance. Now is not the time to turn our backs upon the displaced.
Thank you so much, Anne. Our next speaker is Ava Miller, who's also a senior international and global studies major, and her paper is titled "An Unending Exodus: North African Jews in France."
I'm kind of hoping that everyone can hear me. Well, I hope this mic is working. Does it sort of seem that way?
It's just a recording mic.
Oh, okay.
Okay. Oh, boy.
So my name is Eva Miller, and I'm a senior, an IGS major, International Global Studies, with a minor in Religious Studies. I studied last year in Tunisia for a total of about 7 months. I studied for the first few months with a study abroad program, and with them completed a research project and then continued that research with funding from Sewanee with the Beale Fellowship. So while I was in Tunisia, I was studying the situation of Jewish communities in Tunisia and sort of North Africa more generally today. And while I was doing that research, I sort of developed the idea for the research that I've been continuing this year with the IGS department with my honors thesis that I'm still working on right now, so I haven't reached my full conclusion, so that will be missing a little bit, but we'll work with it. And so while I was studying Jewish communities in Tunisia, which are the oldest in Africa, I discovered, I noticed that a huge number of them have emigrated away from North Africa recently, and by that I mean about the last century. So Tunisia and the rest of North Africa experienced a huge exodus of all of the Jewish communities due to a variety of factors during the 1950s through about the 1970s. And so while I was there, I was doing my research on the communities that stayed, which are numbering only in the thousands at this point. And so this year I decided to continue my research on the ones who actually left and made their homes elsewhere. And so my research is concerning the Jewish and Muslim communities that are now in France. So it's sort of building off of actually both presentations beforehand, because the situation of how Jews are treated in France is definitely connected to this sort of historic treatment of Jews in the region. And yet there's this overlying tone of the fact that so many of them today are North African, and so sort of culturally and ethnically they're from North Africa. And what we're seeing in French society today a lot is that these communities are really being bunched together as sort of immigrants, as opposed to being recognized for their various individual identities. I am working from sort of a distance. I would really like to have been able to include sort of some personal accounts and do sort of my own research as I was able to do while I was abroad, but I'm limited by distance and time, so I'm working mostly from literature that already exists in the field. And luckily enough, there is quite a bit of it, although very little of it is focused on my specific question, so that is working a little in my favor that that work doesn't already exist. But it means that finding information for the situation happening currently today is a little bit difficult to find. So there is a lot of history already done on Jewish-Muslim relations in North Africa, and particularly since the 1950s, 1960s, there's been a fair amount of work done on sort of these immigrant communities in France and a little bit of how they interact with one another, but more sort of how they interact with French society as a whole. And so finding those differences between Muslim and Jewish communities is a little bit more difficult. And I found really that that's where my research is taking me. I really sort of expected when I was going into this that I would be finding sort of rising anti-Semitism within the entire French society, which is causing huge, massive numbers of Jews to migrate away from France today. Numbers that are actually breaking records from France and also from Europe as a whole today. So the number of Jews leaving France today is reaching about 6,000 or 7,000 annually for almost a decade now, and that's breaking numbers even in the first years following the Holocaust, when you were seeing all of those Jews leave Western Europe to go to America and Israel primarily. Even at their peak, those numbers were reaching 2,000 or 3,000 per year. So we're really seeing a huge spike today. And a lot of it is attributed to anti-Semitism, which is sort of undeniable in France right now. And that anti-Semitism is actually rising most, we see, within Muslim communities in France. And it's a little bit interesting, I think, just because sort of that historic anti-Semitism in France that one always thinks of is sort of a little bit directed more towards the Ashkenazi Jews who have this sort of history with the blood libel and sort of money lending. But today it's really identified more with almost Islamophobia, because it's sort of this discrimination against a people and an ethnicity which they share with their Muslim counterparts who also emigrated after the decolonization of North Africa in the 50s. So that leads to these tensions within Muslim and Jewish communities in France, which to be extended, actually they're contained within similar physical spaces as well as sort of their space within French society. And so that's where I think it gets really interesting for me, is this aspect that I think is sort of ignored by a lot of people doing the research in this field, and is just really being recognized more recently, is the physical dimensions of the North African experience in France, which is really reliant on these banlieues, which Anne brought up, which are sort of very comparable to American inner cities, with sort of the economic suppression that they experience, unable to get jobs, really difficult to sort of travel outside of their area, and sort of just stuck within these communities that perpetuate sort of negative violence, crime, all of that. And so what happened was, in around the 1960s and the 1970s, these communities were developed for sort of underdeveloped and working class French families, but who decided in the later 70s and in the 80s that they were able to sort of move out of those zones and move into sort of the nicer French suburbs that they, outside of the cities, that weren't necessarily connected with these sort of economically underdeveloped zones. And so North African families who were very economically underdeveloped were flooding into these communities in the 1970s and the 1980s, and 30, 40 years later, we're still seeing that those communities are dominated by Muslims and Jews and black Africans. And so these communities in 2006 were made up of 50% North Africans. So, you know, less than a decade ago now, that's a long time, these communities were overrun by North Africans. And so, you know, these statistics were fairly easy for me to find, but what's sort of ignored in those statistics are the religious divides within those communities. And so, as far as the Ashkenazi Jews in Europe, the sort of Jews who descend more from the Western European Jewry, I would say, are treated much better in French society, just because they don't have those sort of cultural and ethnic divides so much. And so the anti-Semitism that's rising in France today is not so much against them, but more really against North Africans. And so that anti-Semitism isn't even necessarily just anti-Semitism, but it's really sort of tied up with racism and sort of Islamophobia, like I was saying. It's all tied into one thing. And we're seeing a lot of that coming out of this rise of French nationalism, which is sort of happening all over Europe. And this sort of subjugation of North African communities is coming from this sort of instinct that we're seeing really across the Western world, of the mainstream sort of higher up societies feeling this need to protect themselves from the encroaching immigrants and that sort of outside culture coming in and dominating their own. And so, as opposed to working with these immigrants, within French society, there's been this sort of divide that's been really concrete, solidified into French society for the past half century, of citizen versus immigrant. And so we see that divide, and it's been documented by a lot of people already, is this sort of consideration of the immigrant and the citizen, even if the immigrant has been living in France for their entire life, second, third generation. North Africans, black Africans are considered immigrants still in France, even though they've been raised in France and raised in this culture. And this nationalism we see coming sort of out of this tendency towards away from Catholicism in France. And this has been documented most in one of my primary sources for my paper, called I'm Charlie, and it came out right after the Charlie Hebdo attack, and it sort of discusses this sort of shift away from Catholicism and religious ideology in France towards one that is strengthened by nationalism, towards one that sort of unifies people around that sense of nation and that sense of identity, that seeing as they're no longer using Catholicism to unite themselves, they're using this nationalism. And instead of incorporating North Africans into this national sort of dialogue, they're instead deciding to define themselves against that society. And so I think it's really interesting just looking at how these people interact with one another and how they identify. And that's sort of why I was most interested in coming and doing this conference, because it's so much of this study, so much of all of the things involved revolve around identity and how one interacts with their sense of person, their sense of place, and how they discover how to handle themselves in their environments. And so, I think that those are my main topics. And I was saying, I'm still doing this project, and so my conclusions are a little bit up in the air. As far as I'm standing right now, I'm really seeing this uptick in anti-Semitism and the subsequent sort of exodus of Jewry from France as really a rise in anti-Semitism, as has been sort of documented by other people, but that this anti-Semitism is really being perpetuated and caused and sort of just driven by this necessity almost within French society to divide themselves, to unite against an other. And that other has been identified as the immigrant in France. And all of this is made a little bit more terrifying by the recent developments, not even recent at this point, but sort of the immense strength of the National Front that we're seeing, like Anne was saying, led today by Jean-Marie Le Pen's daughter, Marine Le Pen, who is today one of the 11 final candidates for the presidency that is coming up in France. And so we'll see how that goes. But all of that being said, these sort of nationalist sentiments in France are really causing a lot more tension than we might just see on the surface.
Thank you, Ava. For our final speaker, we're going to move from Europe to our own backyard. With Amber Lane, who is a senior history major, and her discussion on reconstructing the landscape, lessons from the Tennessee Valley Authority.
It's always so easy going last. So for those of you who don't know me, I grew up in the local community, and so I spent a fair amount of time at lakes created by the Tennessee Valley Authority. Early on, I began contrasting the various stories that range from overwhelming fascination with the TVA's engineering achievements and the boundless disdain for the agency's controversial tactics of rural displacement. Mm-hmm. While preparing for this paper, I had the opportunity to speak with Dr. David Wisnat, a historian and professor well known for his contributions to Appalachian and place-based studies. I asked Dr. Wisnat several questions about his perspective on the importance of place, specifically hinting at the Tennessee Valley. He told me a story about an encounter with two young men who were still reeling from having to leave their childhood home, and how it was unfortunate because their family had been in the same place for so long. He then asked if the story sounded like it could have occurred in the rural South, and I said yes. He then proceeded to tell me I was wrong. He stated that he didn't think that people in this region have any more special attachment to place than someone in New York, where the two men in the story were from. This conversation made me think that maybe it's perhaps how we leave a place that determines how we remember and feel about the event of relocation. Certainly, forced displacement would cause disdain, as documented in the case of the TVA. By looking at cases of rural displacement, as well as looking briefly at the global impact of the TVA, I think that there are clear and important lessons that the TVA has left us through their controversial practice of relocation. The purpose of this particular paper is not to demonize the TVA, but to add to the scholarship about place-based studies and the study of the agency. It also serves as part of a contrasting narrative to those that have been solely celebratory of the Tennessee Valley Authority, as well as to remind us of the sacrifices those in the local area had to make to benefit the region. The Tennessee Valley Authority was created in 1933 in the midst of the Great Depression by President Franklin Roosevelt. The TVA sought to eliminate some of the hardships in the region, but however, in doing so, it also displaced around 14,000 people. The histories and stories of those who were displaced have inspired works of fiction, songs, and even movies, such as the Coen brothers, O Brother, Where Art Thou? These stories, though, do more than romanticize the project and leave us with the eerie uncertainty of what is beneath the man-made lakes of the South. These histories also give us insight into the course of modernization, which indicates a substantial historical process. The stories of displacement additionally help to reveal complex relationships between an institution and the effect it had on local people. The Tennessee Valley Authority dramatically reconstructed the landscape and in turn reconstructed how people lived their daily lives. The institution was designed to have a multifaceted approach to the problems that the Tennessee Valley faced. The TVA Act outlined the mission of the agency to control flooding, improve river navigation, and provide cheap hydroelectric power in the Tennessee Valley that encompasses seven states even today. The TVA Act ensured the right to eminent domain to convert private land for public use. In theory, and sometimes in practice, this seemed unfair. The process of fair compensation for seizing land is where increased resistance to the TVA began to occur. The Tennessee Valley Authority realized that compensation would be one of the more important economic investments the agency would make. The TVA agents, tasked with the difficult mission of starting the process of acquiring private land for the greater good of the public, underestimated the desire of those in the area to stay. Archive documents reveal the frustration felt by those who had to move and those in charge of making them move. These frustrations call attention to the lack of understanding about what constituted an acceptable way of life and standard of living in relation to monetary gain and uprooting one's entire life. An example of these frustrations are evident in primary sources that detail a complicated relationship between the TVA and the Randolph family in Anderson County, Tennessee. The records and notes kept by TVA agent Greta Biddle documented the somewhat exhausting relationship between the agency and the Randolph family during the time of the TVA's first project, Norris Dam. Ms. Biddle noted that the head of this family seemed to be Maddie Randolph, a fiery woman determined not to move her family. Her husband, Jim, an unemployed coal miner, and their seven children were deemed a serious problem for the TVA. The Randolphs lived in a two-room shack made of logs where they lacked sufficient shelter, clothing, and sanitation facilities. Biddle and other federal relief agents were surprised at how content and happy the family seemed to be, considering that they lacked so much. Biddle concluded in her notes that the Randolph family had a very low standard of living. The Randolphs, like many other rural residents, found that there is almost no suitable value to be placed on their homes and communities. Biddle viewed this unwillingness due to a lack of understanding about the purpose and the meaning of the Tennessee Valley Authority. She believed that rural residents like the Randolphs were focusing too heavily on what was to be lost and not gained from this project. In 2010, a Cleveland, Tennessee newspaper ran an article that featured Charlie Randolph, one of the seven children who was 9 years old at the time of eviction. He resentfully recalled that the family stayed until the waters rose and that they picked corn by boat as they drifted away from their family home and farm. He also recalled that the problem of displacement led the family to live in a tent for a year until they found another home to purchase. Stories told by those who were relocated emphasize the overwhelming difficulty people had abandoning their homes and communities. These stories are often undervalued, which only continues to distance the institution from the myth of the grassroots organization it set out to build. Michael McDonald and John Muldowney, former professors of history at the University of Tennessee, Knoxville, compiled an extensive collection of oral histories from residents in the area where the first TVA dam was built. A brief excerpt from an interview with two Norris residents helped some of the underlying response to the project. Evelyn Longmire and Ruby Sampson, both displaced residents, believe that most people felt about the same. Longmire attributed the feelings of discontentment towards the TVA to their lack of consideration to people's attachments to their home, land, and interwoven communities. She stated to McDonald and Muldowney that the thing that hurt so bad was that we just didn't want to be taken away from the place that we loved. Even if we did go away, we would like to come back someday. Now it's 100 feet underwater and we can never go home again. Sentiments like this one are an intricate and important expression of feelings towards the TVA's lasting legacy among the people it was created to help. My personal interview with former Franklin County resident Martha Sutton echoed some of the same ideas and reactions found in McDonald and Baldoni's work. Sutton's family was removed from her 100-acre farm in Awalt, Tennessee, which is now underwater and in the location of Thames Ford Lake. This particular dam was constructed in the 1960s for the purpose of economic development and recreation. The project moved along rather quickly, following a routine that the TVA had been practicing since 1933. The speed in which Thames Ford Dam was constructed could give the impression that the local community had few to no objections to the construction of the dam. However, there are many who have stories similar to that of Ms. Sutton. Ms. Sutton stated that she believed she was nearing the time of starting college early when her family was forced to move. During our time together, Ms. Sutton described the town of AWOL and how her family lived. She was still proud of the self-sustaining nature her family possessed and their ability to grow their own food and make the things that they needed that they couldn't buy at the local store. She described her day-to-day life in the town and even told me stories about how her and her mother would sell baseballs by hand to be sold through a company in nearby Tullahoma in Tennessee. Towards the end of our initial conversation, she told me more about the local store that she kept mentioning and the man who owned the business. She described him as kind and an overall good man. She stated that even before the TVA really moved into the area, the tensions in the community were high. She told me the story of a local man who didn't live too far from her family's home that believed the store owner, Mr. Roten, had sided with the TVA and had a hand in encouraging them to come to AWOLT to inspect the land for the construction of what would be Tim's Ward Dam. This caused quite the controversy and led this local neighbor to walk into the town store and shoot the owner. Mr. Roten did not die from his injuries, but they were substantial. Martha Sutton explained that some were just that upset about the proposed dam that they would resort to violence. I was both surprised and interested to find that Martha Sutton's reactions to the TVA coming into her local community were notably similar to those documented by the families displaced in the Norris Project in the 1930s. Sutton also expressed her continuous disdain and lack of interest in the TVA because they, in her own words, tried to take everything her family had ever worked for and did not care about the community they were removing. Recollections like these help us identify the separation between the TVA's vision and the reality of the impact it had on the people it was created to serve. While the impact of the TVA can be traced locally, its mission can be felt globally. The late United States Supreme Court Justice William O. Douglas stated once after his travels that everywhere I went, people asked, why can't we have a TVA? The TVA idea has been translated into the TVA model for developing countries, particularly those who have the ability to benefit the United States. If the TVA could alleviate poverty and bring America's most downtrodden region up to speed with the rest of the country, then surely this model could be carried elsewhere to do the same for others struggling to reach progress. One of the most well-funded projects using the TVA model outside of the United States was the effort in the Mekong Basin of Vietnam. This investment was to run alongside the military intervention and provide aid to the country, as well as neighboring countries such as Cambodia. The blueprint for the TVA has also been carried to other parts of Asia, as well as Africa. These aid investments were met with little, if any, success, as well as criticism because of the large-scale displacement of residents, among other factors. To summarize, the lessons the TVA has taught us at home and abroad tell us more about the functions of rural communities and the ethnology of rural people. The profound compromise these communities were forced into are lessons in how far we will go to justify progress through institutions such as the Tennessee Valley Authority, as well as how we conceptualize concerns about poverty and development. Micah Cash, a photographer whose latest work focuses on the impact of the TVA, sums up the results of the TVA's history by stating that while these dams have become symbols of social and economic prosperity, they also remain visual reminders of loss, population removal, and eminent domain. The accompanying recreational land is a civic contract to the descendants of those families that were relocated into the memory of inundated ancestral land. This, in my opinion, accurately reflects the lasting attitudes towards the TVA today and the relevance of these sites of displacement as culturally and historically significant.
Thank you, Amber. That was fascinating. Does anyone have any questions for the speakers or comments?
Yes. I have a question for Professor Engel.
Yes, Professor.
What is the connection between Veronica's veil and the persecution of Jews in the Middle East?
Yes. What I'm trying to show is a positive and a negative instantiation of interacting with Christ and a living memorial, so that her veil becomes that which continues after Christ as man has left the earth, as the sign of his messianic being. The wandering Jew is that negative example who must bear witness
saw Jesus when he was here first, and at the end of days he'll be released. Does that make sense?
Yes. Is this veil still, I believe it was in Milan at one point,
yes.
Right?
Yes, that's where the last pope was visiting it.
Yes.
And that raises all kinds of interesting questions about the reality of the relic or the spiritual, yes, right, symbolic signification. And what's more interesting to me on that aspect is that Benedict was very careful not to claim its status as a proper relic. But he still visited it.
Many times.
Yes, sir.
Any other questions?
I have a question for Amber. That was great. I really enjoyed the oral history, the ethnography part. And I was wondering if, I know there was this project of photography, like people like Lang went and photographed the project. And you mentioned fiction, so are you looking into fiction too? And I was wondering if fiction and photography match like the oral histories and sentiments or what they represent, or if they afford something else.
They do in a way. A lot of the stories that people tell do kind of line up with the photography and the movies and the songs that people have created. And it can show you both sides of the project, which is something that I think has become recently emerging in the field of studying the TVA. Because for so long, the narrative was that the TVA was a really good thing for the region because it brought in so many jobs and electricity and gave people a way of life that they previously didn't have. While on the other side, people didn't really ask for that, and they weren't really asked what they really wanted and needed. And so I think that the things like fiction and photography are really great at showing both sides of that, and I hope that there's more of it coming out.
Yes.
I have a question that Ann or Eva could answer. To what extent do you think birth rate is a factor of anti-immigrant feelings in France?
I know that it's brought up as a statistic pretty regularly within sort of the public discourse in France because, the statistic is that Muslims in France have, I think, 3 to 4 children on average, and mainstream French family has 2. But I think that I feel like it's almost sort of a little bit of an afterthought just because it's not something that's present in everybody's sort of vision every single day. It's not like the veil where it's every time that you see someone, that's the first thing that you think of. But I think that it's definitely something that people are trying to point to, saying, we're going to let in a ton of refugees now, and then in 50 years, they're going to proliferate it into this big, sort of much larger population. I know that it's brought up, but I don't think it plays a huge role in it personally.
Yeah, that honestly never came up in my research.
Other questions?
I want to say they were really good. This is a really good panel, so I really enjoyed it. And student papers were. All papers are great. Very good. I actually have a question to Bill. My question was actually about, obviously there's a Reconquista, and so there was a sort of, anti-Semitism involved in that, also obviously anti-Islam as well. But there's something about Protestantism and the rise of Luther that you sort of talk about here,
yes.
And this sort of, you've got this succession in the late 1200s, is this something specific? Is it the millenarian sort of vision, like the end of times is coming, that the Jew is something that, because you mentioned the wandering Jew will be there at the end of time, it's coming.
That's what Luther was really counting on.
Yeah.
He thought that would be the, no pun intended, the final nail in the door truth of his Reformation, because that would be the new face of Christianity. Once all the Jews saw the truth of that and converted, boom, we have I think for a while, Luther really did believe that, correct me if I'm wrong, but he saw this as an end time.
Yeah.
As other millenarians
did. The book is unbelievable, in its anti-Semitism.
Yes.
But I was just wondering if you could maybe connect that to sort of modern sort of evangelical thought, right? Because there is this kind of connection to the end of days,
yes.
And also a lot of sort of, Christian Zionism that,
yes,
is very complicated.
Yes.
For this very reason, right?
Yeah. I still remember very vividly being in
person, that the Bush administration, the last Bush administration, was very favorable toward Israel because of the evangelical worldview of the Bush family. And they thought somehow linking to Israel would help affect the end of days. And so you get all kinds of, I'll call them radical conservative Christians, pro-Israel and wanting even a whole movement believing you have to become a Jew in order to become a true Christian again. So it's politically fraught, as we might imagine. And I think it ties in with some of the papers, particularly the European ones that we heard, this sense of trying to co-opt traditions and or erase differences. But I mean, you might have had something to say about the differences that when we want them to work, like, oh, I want to wear my veil because it's part of my identity. Or is it now the law that for passports, the Jeep has to be removed for the pictures?
In the United States, you can wear it.
Yeah.
Your ears have to be showing.
Right, but in France, I think. Mm-hmm.
In France, you have to remove it.
Yeah.
I was very struck by the racial differences. I mean, what really struck me was this idea of sort of erasing religious differences by making religious differences illegal, right? Highlighting
yes.
those religious differences illegal. Well, in your paper, we talked about highlighting religious
yes.
difference through time, and also then what Ava was saying about, you know, the Jews. It was sort of a racial issue, right? Because Ashkenazi Jews can walk down the street and look white in France, whereas North African Jews
yes.
don't have that same. So very, very much sort of those racial undertones, and it makes me wonder. And I don't know. And if you've thought about this, what the effect of those laws actually are? You know, do they? I mean, it's a policy decision, obviously, to prevent religious symbolism, but one aimed mostly at hijab and bikinis on the beach. But what difference can that really make when North Africans still present as North Africans, and the even the North African Jews who wouldn't be wearing hijab anyway are singled out.
yes, I haven't thought of that before, but I really wanted to find more personal accounts
mm-hmm.
when I was writing my paper, which was really, really hard to find. There's not much literature written by immigrants who live in France. That is a good point.
more things to think about.
Yes, I
need to. Well, I have a sort of question for you two, both of you, in a way that sort of relates to this. I mean, is basically the rise of the far right really basically saying assimilation is no longer possible? Is that essentially what this is all about? I mean, because if you present laïcité as this sort of goal, right? And so in some ways, you know, from the outside, you know, I think we don't like the idea that everybody has to become the same, but at least there's an opportunity there rather than a Muslim ban, right? Just
mm-hmm.
saying, you know, I'm not saying one is necessarily better than the other, but it seems like now that isn't even possible, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
right.
this is quite interesting and,
well,
you know.
Maybe the Muslim ban is the next step then, right? If
yeah,
it's
no,
not
that's
possible
what I'm wondering,
to assimilate
right?
and it's not possible to erase racial difference, then, or ethnographic difference.
Yeah.
I think a lot of the fracture, at least there, from my understanding of the situation, and Ms. Kirk and Ms. Miller, you can correct me if I'm wrong, is that there's such a long-standing tradition from the standardizing of French lycée education and the early intelligence test and who's going to get to go into school and be workers, that the fracture now is, well, that's not working, and so now we need to make a cutoff.
Well, we might see that with the possible election of Marine Le Pen.
Or at least a coalition government.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think it's interesting because so many people within sort of the public dialogue in France are really, so many people are saying that Islam is just unreconcilable with French secularism and with laïcité, and that there's just a disconnect there, that if you are of Islamic faith from that tradition, that you know, you can't participate fully in French society as French citizens are meant to. But, you know, that's not really the problem because you see studies in France where they'll send out, you know, 100 job applications, 1,000 job applications, the same application, but with two different names. And I think it's a pretty well-known study, but
you send out a French name with one resume and the same resume but with sort of a more North African sounding name, and you get less than a quarter of the number of job offers. I mean, really less than 20%. It's ridiculous. And so, you know, whereas a lot of people are saying Islam is just unreconcilable, well, you know, whether that's the case or not, it's clearly not the rationale, or else, you know, somebody with a North African name very well might be Christian or Jewish, and they're still being discriminated against because of their name or their ethnicity. So
I would say that the counter to that, one of the opposing views on that is held by school teachers. And this is the school teachers since 1905, and really before that, have been given the mission of secularizing everyone.
Yes.
And so ironically, public schools now are often majority immigrant because a lot of traditionally French-born students are being sent by their parents to private schools. And private schools, unlike public schools, can discriminate in the entrance into the school, whereas the public schools have to take everyone. And so it's left to the public school teachers to transform all of these immigrant, French-born and French citizens,
yes,
children, into good secular French people. And it's ironic, in my own life, in my own witness of the situation, is I have many left-leaning friends who have sent their children to private schools because they feel that the public schools are too violent, are too is a situation, gives the students a situation where conflict reigns instead of education, because the teachers are dealing with differing points of view within this the immigrant populations, and there are many different ones. It's not just North African. But anyway, I would say that if there's anything that's going to save the situation, it's the public school teachers who are devoted to this mission.
There's an interesting thing there, right? The conspicuousness of the symbol. It's okay to wear a small cross.
No,
right?
It is not.
It isn't? They changed that now?
Yeah, that
they changed that? But
no.
It used to for a while, right? It used
no.
to be that you could wear it.
In those laws that Anne was talking about, it included all religions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All wear a kippah, you can't wear a crucifix.
Okay,
wear
you could for a while. Okay. No.
Is it only on your person? So could you have a mezuzah on your front door?
No, this is
probably not a public
housing.
Not in public housing. Right.
It's only in public spaces.
Only in public spaces.
Yeah.
I've got a question that's sort of related to these ideas, and it requires a bit of a comparative lens. And I'm curious what individuals, in particular, two speakers in the middle, think about this. It seems to be the case that what's happening in France, this xenophobia, is driven. Driven by France's secularism, whereas when we look at much of the xenophobia that is occurring in other places in the world, including the U.S., seems to be driven by religious fundamentalism. How do we reconcile, you know, how is it that we see what I view as very similar patterns going on across these two places, shifts towards the far right, for example, but driven by completely different ideological viewpoints when it comes to religion?
I think that's been what's made this situation and this question so interesting for two centuries now, is the French question, you know, in Western Europe, where it's sort of, you see so many of the same trends and so many of the same things in France as you see sort of in Germany and in England and sort of across Europe. And yet, when you actually look at the sort of causes for these effects, they're so vastly different. So, you know, you've got British nationalism versus French nationalism, which are very, very different concepts, and yet they're both very strong and sort of are perpetuating these sort of racist and sort of conservative views today. But yeah, in France, so much of it has been based since the French Revolution on, you know, we are all French citizens above everything, no matter what, we're French, and then everything else comes beneath that. And yet, you know, and that was sort of encouraged for a long time over the, you know, 19th century, and then the 20th century comes along, and all of these immigrants come into Western Europe, and a ton of immigrants come into France, just particularly after decolonization, but even during the period of colonization, you've got a lot of immigrants going to France. And so they'd already been sort of developing this culture of secularism and really, you know, creating a sense of French identity that didn't really include these immigrants who suddenly, a century later, are swarming into France and creating this completely different new population, which now is one of, you know, France's immigrant population is one of the largest in Europe, and it's, you know, been a pretty recent thing relatively, and so they've sort of had to define themselves against it, which is what they've chosen to do, as opposed to sort of finding a way to integrate it more.
Do you think it has to do with sort of assimilation into the dominant culture, whereas the dominant culture, maybe in the United States, is more of a Judeo-Christian and mostly Christian culture, whereas in France there's sort of this constructed dominant culture of secularity? Does that?
Yeah, then it's just the pathway that they...
Right, then it's a question of assimilation more than the sort of blocks to assimilation that are giving rise to the xenophobia.
But if we can bring Amber's paper in as well, we can sort of think projects of modern reform, right?
Yes.
Often require conformity.
Mm-hmm.
And like there's a particular vision, right, that are going to leave some people out of it.
Yes.
Or not even talk about them. Or put them into a position of, that's not who we are.
Or make assumptions about ways of life.
These people actually seem to work quite well together here.
Yeah.
And, you know, obviously Luther was involved in, for the time, a project of modern reform that has this sort of immediacy because he thinks the end of times is coming. I'm not sure French state is thinking the end of times is coming, but it's something for right-wing nationalists, yes, the end of time is coming. Right? So, I think they're all involved in these kind of modern reform projects that requires a certain amount of discipline and sort of domination.
Well, and these are all the marginalized groups. So
yeah.
In
yes.
all circumstances,
right.
Across all of them, they're the marginalized and the powerless.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The ones forced to move.
Right.
I think what Ms. Lane's paper brings out for all of us sort of as an overarching thing is the economic prosperity goal and model to the exclusion of any possible things that might go awry. So I don't want to say it all comes down to a sort of economics of equality, but it kind of does.
One of the things that
and who's deciding that?
Right. One of the things that really struck me as someone who studies U.S. immigration policy is right now, with the idea of the border wall being built on the southern border, the government is empowered to use eminent domain to seize property along the border. And that really, this idea of sort of modernization and this project, where on the one hand we have, you know, the TVA that has this sort of lofty goal, and now we have a border wall, which some people may think is a lofty goal, but not too many academics. I'm wondering, Amber, if there was any lesson from the sort of histories that you read and conducted yourself about what might mitigate the effects for families or for individuals who are displaced in these projects, either in the U.S. or abroad.
That's a really good question. A lot of my own like oral histories that I conducted and then looking back on ones that were already done, a lot of the families had a hard time buying into the dream of the TVA,
mm-hmm.
especially because as the administration of the agency changed, so did the vision.
Mm-hmm.
They had a new idea, a new goal like every 5 to 10 years, and in the beginning it was a lot more because there were so many internal conflicts within the agency. It's kind of interesting because in a lot of the projects carried out with the TVA, they really took advantage of situations where they could convince people that this is really what they needed. So in the beginning, the Great Depression, trying to sell the dream of rural electrification for people who probably couldn't really conceptualize what that meant,
mm-hmm.
it would have been beneficial for the TVA to take a step back in the beginning and explain to them what the benefits would have been instead of waiting to relocate entire communities, then to tell them, you know, how to use their new refrigerator or their new dryer. And with the Thames Ford Dam, it actually started because the Tellico Plains project was postponed because they couldn't get the funding, but they still wanted to move forward with a project with this new mission. And so the idea of recreation and economic prosperity in Franklin County was really appealing to local politicians primarily and not so much the residents. Because at that time, the economic prosperity was coming mostly from Huntsville because of the space race.
Yes.
And then with nearby Arnold Air Force, the engineering complex. And so they thought that the people who worked there, the engineers and the scientists, would be willing to spend their money to buy boats to, you know, play in the lake, and that didn't really happen. And so it left a lot of people really disappointed.
Does anyone else have any questions or comments?
It sounds like it's a consumer model too. Yeah. Yes. What you do with the land or with the environment,
yeah.
creating new desires that would fuel
yes.
industries, mm-hmm. and then they don't pan out.
Yeah, especially in the beginning, General Electric had a very strong relationship with the TVA, and they had a lot of local cooperatives through, primarily I think, the University of Tennessee at Knoxville, and so they showed people how to use new fertilizers, how to, you know, use their new refrigerator, their new stove. They wash clothes inside for the first time, and that was really exciting. And they tried to sell this, I guess, idea that you could cut down the time that you spent doing your daily activities by probably less than half, which really kind of went against the way that people live their everyday lives. And so it was really overwhelming for a lot of people in the Tennessee Valley.
Any other questions or comments? Thank you all to all the panelists.